What is up, everybody? This is Tikoy, also known as Richard, and I'm coming back to you with another Costa game. This time it's going to be a team game. We're playing on King of the Hill, and I'll show you with the new Holy Roman Empire as perfect as it can get, really, with your build order and what you expect. So let's just close this UI here on top. We don't need that. Main thing is you have your six villagers immediately on sheep. You don't move the prelate. And in this map, you want to stick to the sides. I'll just reveal so you can see. But basically, this is very rare in 1v1 games. But the main thing is you can see all these sheeps are there's no sheep here in the middle, right? This what you see right here, this is not always happening. You'll mostly find them running around the side, like what you see right here and here. So I have a second scout out going this way, keybind 3. I accidentally trained another scout, so it's keybind 4, and then there should be a scout this side somewhere. Let's just see if I can find it. There we go, keybind 1. So town center, you press H, keybind 2. So I have first scout, third scout, second or third scout, just keybinds 3 and 4, and main town center. Now you take 3 inspired villagers and you move them over to gold, and you want to go up to 8 food. And you have 3 gold, 8 food, and these villagers, these 3 gold villagers, will basically stay there until Imperial Age. You really don't have to move them, and this is really nice. You can hear as we're picking up those sheep. We already brought 4, 6 back, and you can see this scout already has another 7, and this scout has another 5. So really nice. What you can also do if you want to scout a little bit quicker, you bring these two scouts together, you select the sheep, you move them on top onto the scout, you basically select them as a unit, and you rally them onto this scout, and then you can use the scout to continue scouting, and you don't have to return with both of them. So I'm running back. We have some really, really high food now from all these sheep we're bringing back. It's 250 food per sheep, and if you bring back 10 sheep, that's 2,500 food. Just to put it in comparison, that's how much deer a whole boar is. So just remember, boars are worth pushing in this game. A lot of people don't. The Rus has a nice strategy of doing that, but I mean, any faction can really do that. It's just they can garrison 8 villagers in an outpost where we can only garrison 5. So it's pretty effective because 8 is like the perfect number around a carcass. So you have the 3, you have the 8. You can see I'm garrisoning now over to wood. And I will take 4 villagers. You can see I will bring one back, but 4 villagers to build your ridge, your ark and chapel. And when you are building the Ark and Chapel, there's a video on Beastie Cutie where he explains Ark and Chapel placement. But what you can see now, just quickly, I'll send my scouts out to get vision on the enemy. One is already here at the back. Your Ark and Chapel priority is going to be sheep, or preferably deer, which is not a priority right now. Then berries and sheep, then wood, then gold. So if in this type of case, residence cathedral placement wise, you also don't want to have it forward, because if you transition into farms, you want to be able to do it safely, and safely would have been perfect back here. So this residence cathedral spot back here would have been better, and then moving the sheep to the side here means that I would have had the berries, the sheep, and the wood line inspired, so I wouldn't have these wood villagers running without inspiration, and then I just send a prelate onto the gold, and then I know my gold villagers are good. Now once you go onto 3 wood villagers, you take your redsnits, oh, sorry, your town center, and you garrison onto the gold until you go up to 6. That's a safe amount, but I'll explain to you why. So now you can see we have a scout here at the back, another scout right over here. I'm just doing a bit of harassment, but you're not going to do much with a prelate on top of them. So we're just causing a bit of harm, trying to see if he reacts to it, trying to see if he stops with the gold. He's actually going for a what do you call this landmark? Mineswork Palace. And we have all the vision that we need. You can see I'm positioning my scouts, like, if you consider tower rushing or making forward towers, right? This is pretty nice. what the Chinese player in my team is doing. He's walling off, which is a big security to his base. He has a forward Barbican of the Sun that's securing the gold and the berries. And I've said this in a lot of my previous villagers. If you're going for a defensive landmark or a keep or something like that, you want to be placing them in a place where you are securing resources. So on top of these berries, on top of these gold mines or the sacred site. But if you place it on sacred site, do it forward, please. Don't do it here at the back, because there's like this hill happening like this, and because of the hill, your springholds will struggle with line of sight when you build military to defend that. So now you can see the Argon Chapel is done. The gold villagers are inspired. Food villagers are inspired. I'm building a mill so I can transition into wheelbarrow, getting my house economy sorted, and now getting up to 12 villagers on food so I can go for my prelates and possibly men at arms. Now, what I'm doing, and this is also very important, guys, is to scout out your enemy properly so you also know what's going on. You can see I have scouts all over the map. Our Chinese player also has scouts out, but we have a scout right here. The second one should be close by, or I lost it, I'm not sure. There we go, there's the one, there's the other one. I could just probably use my keybinds like I told you guys instead of scouting across the map. But now I'm running around his base to kind of find what's going on. We already saw one barracks that gives you an idea of early men at arms. The English player does have a council hall and going to try and secure a forward gold here. But because of the council hall, we are keeping an eye with this tower and the scout on how many archers is available and how many is actually being trained. You can also see he has vision on this barracks, but there's no early minute or vanguard minute arms coming out. But what I want to keep an eye on is specifically this barracks, because the Holy Roman Empire has access to early men-at-arms, which you can upgrade to as the English. You can upgrade to men-at-arms, sorry, so that's only castle age. So you go from vanguard to straight to men-at-arms, so you don't have early men-at-arms as the English. But the most important thing is I want to see how many men-at-arms are getting trained out here. So if he's rushing, we can have some form of defense going. Now, because of the Burggrave Palace, he will be aggressive getting the siege engineering, getting the extra armor, and the extra, you can see, ranged armor already. So he's getting all the right upgrades. In my personal opinion, if you go for this, you want the siege engineering, then the ranged armor, melee damage, the bloomery, and then siege engineering. That gives you enough time to mass up some men at arms before you rush. Now I went for something a little bit different. I see the double barracks, so I just dropped down a double barracks as a safety net, and you can see we are rallying now onto the gold. What I did here was a little wrong. You want to go 6 on gold early and then onto the wood. So basically you go 3 wood, 6 gold then, and then back onto the wood line as soon as you have the 12 villagers on food. Now I'm speed building a little here, 4 villagers building this Red Sins Cathedral, and the reason why I don't want to rush it too much, you'll see, I want this gold to come in while I'm reaching this landmark age up time. I want to have prelates in the queue so I can actually send them out and get those relics as soon as this landmark is done. Either defend it with units or defend it by attacking, and having those relics secured, but you want to have those relics secured early on. Now you can see he's moving over to the other Holy Roman Empire players, moving over to Foodier. I think I lose the scout here. Unfortunately, we have another scout here just giving vision on what's happening. And the English and Holy Roman Empire is now pushing together against this China. But China already has his a high number of outposts up. He has the Barbican of the Sun. And he has these palisade gates, palisade walls up so he can defend. So you can see he's harming some berries, securing extra food, denying this forward gold. But, you know, if this is what you're playing against, you want to make sure you're also getting those age ups and upgrades so you don't run behind. Now, you can see now with the prelate is getting rallied to the first relic that side. We have one right here already available. And if you want to secure a third one, you can drop the buff out of the Arcan Chapel if you are not training one. And send that to a relic as well. And you want to primarily try and secure your furthest relics first if you have the time and the safety, so that you don't run into an issue later on when trying to secure them. I'm also building an outpost because I know once I pick up these relics, only two goes into the Regent's Cathedral. The rest can go into outposts, and outposts will actually give you gold when you place it in there. It's also 100 gold per outpost. So we do get extra gold as the Holy Roman Empire. The only difference is with dropping them inside the Redstone Cathedral, you get a 200% bonus gold instead of the 100% from a outpost. Now a big push coming in here from these two players, pushing with men-at-arms. They have some of those upgrades, as you can see. Plus one armor, plus one damage. Little Wallalore coming in here to just get the scout off my back, so I can get that scout and the relic. You can see we did pick up this first relic now, which was here. We picked up the second relic, which was here, and the third relic, which was here. And that's at the 11-minute mark, and going for a fourth and a fifth one, which would be this one and that one. And building the outposts to assist in dropping those relics off, right? Now, that's going to really, really make a big difference in your gold. But what you can see now, we know the teammate is under pressure, and we can't just leave that. So immediately, my men-at-arms are coming out. But first, I'm starting with the upgrade, so I don't have to worry about that. If you have to choose between a blacksmith upgrade and your vanguard early men-at-arms, or elite men-at-arms upgrade, please get these upgrades first. They are worth so much more. I'll show you shortly, as soon as these men-at-arms come out, the difference, because these early men-at-arms are 3-3 and they're sieging down now, but it's they should have, I think, let's see, there we go, 11 damage, right? Now he's inside the enemy's base. That sound you heard earlier was me donating resources to my enemy, or ally, I mean, so he can at least train some units up. But at the same time, I'm dropping down some extra barracks, and I'm gonna rally out some land cannons and men-at-arms. Land cannons really nice with splash damage, 17 damage, but no armor, so squishy unit, but really nice to complement them into your team. And we know this unit, this enemy will get, or this ally will get pushed really hard with this double ram and archer and men-at-arm push. But I want to show you guys how quickly it makes a difference once you have a few men-at-arms out, how quickly you can help and defend against this. So we have the two relics right here, another relic in this outpost, another relic in that outpost. And then we move our prelates to places where we aren't inspired. You can see onto the wood line, onto the stone here, which is actually inspired. So this is a bit of a waste. Onto the gold if you can. And now you can see we have the rally and five barracks, very comfortable 900 gold per minute, and that's with zero villagers on gold. This is all just because of the relics that we have. Now, in team games, just do yourself a favor. You can see the +4, +4, 14 damage. He did put a nice little keep down. I did donate some resources, so he's able to stabilize his economy. And all he wants to do is just deal with the masses. But this Chukunu would do really well against early men-at-arms. Archers, probably they'll lose against. Yes, they get the three shots off, but they you need high numbers to really be dealing with this. To just shoot with those units at this, it's a problem. Now, I have four units right here, okay? And this is early men-at-arms versus men-at-arms, and we have those heavy mace upgrades. So you can see there's 14 damage plus 6 against cavalry or heavy units. You can see there's plus 6 versus heavy. So any enemy men-at-arms will take extra damage from this, and the land cannon will do a bit of splash damage. If you see at these archers, there's three archers that went down immediately, and that's the land cannon doing those type of damage. And that was four or five units that we had early on. You can see his men-at-arms falling back now. Little scout here on top of my prelate. But there's the sixth, third tower now, and I do get the fortification outpost upgrades plus the aerosolids. It gives you basically a forward keep with the three towers to give you a bit of defense. And we have three relics there, four, five, so five total relics with a total of over 800 gold per minute because of those relics. You get the 200% increased here, so there you can see the first 600 gold per minute from those two relics, and then 100 per outpost. You can see it right here. So that's what you want to be focusing on with the Holy Roman Empire. If you're not getting pressured, that is the best way to play the Holy Roman Empire. Get those relics, because if you compare it to anyone else, let's just quickly use this as an example, right? Income per minute, I'm sitting on 800. And if you check on the people, there's 9 villagers on gold here for the boiler squid, and he's only on 400 gold per minute. So effectively, you need 18 villagers to supplement that type of gold income. You can see here for Wallace, the English player, 340. It's also 9 villagers. And Isbeth, he has 330, more or less. You can see gold per minute here is less than 100, but that's all because of the relics. I have 0 villagers on gold, and that's the amount of gold we're getting per minute, just because of the relics. It's really, really strong if you leave the Holy Roman Empire. So now, to get relics. Now I have some men-at-arms here and land cannons, a few crossbows that we added in, to help and defend. The crossbows is actually from him. Sorry, we just have the men-at-arms. There was a few land cannons, but they're not there right now. But we're fighting against early men-at-arms with upgraded men-at-arms with the mace upgrade. So they'll just slice through these enemy men-at-arms like there's no tomorrow. And this is both double from the Holy Roman Empire and the English player. Both of them were early men-at-arms, and we had men-at-arms with a land cannon or two in between there. And you can see here another few men-at-arms come in, and we win the game. So basically what I want to say with regards to the build order, you can see I'm transitioning into farm and wood and whatever. But that early push for Castle Age is based on your scouting and is based on how quickly you can get into that Castle Age and get those prelates out. Don't rush your Regnance Cathedral if you don't have prelates out on the field already to pick up those relics. Otherwise, you know, you're just delaying your own time. But thank you very much for watching, guys. I'll see you guys in the next video.